They say imitation is the most sincerest form of flattery. But when it comes to music, sometimes imitation can get you sued. In this video, I would like to take a look at some well-known and not so well-known cases of bands accused of ripping off other artists. I will also offer my opinion on whether I think that the public opinion was right or wrong. This is Dancing with Ghosts. When Nirvana's 1991 album Nevermind came out, their label wanted a second single to follow the colossal Smells Like Teen Spirit. The label wanted to release Come As You Are, but Cobain was reluctant as he knew the main guitar riff in the song was very similar to the Killing Joke song. Killing Joke eventually would try to take the band to court over the song, but there are reports that the case was thrown out, which didn't sit well with Killing Joke's guitarist Jordy Walker. Quote, "I was very pissed off about that, but it's obvious to everyone. We had two separate musicologist reports saying it was. Our publisher sent their publisher a letter saying it was, and they went, 'Boo, never heard of ya!' But the hysterical thing about Nirvana saying they'd never heard of us was that they'd already sent us a Christmas card."
The evidence is pretty clear in this situation. The guitar riff from Come As You Are, right down to that warbly chorus effect, is the exact same as the riff from the Killing Joke song, just slowed down a little bit. Even Kurt Cobain knew it. That's why he didn't want to release the song as a single, because he knew the band was gonna eventually catch wind. The band Killing Joke should have definitely gotten some royalties from the profits made from the Come As You Are song.
In 2013, the Pharrell and Robin Thicke song Blurred Lines was an inescapable summer banger. However, the folks over at the Marvin Gaye estate felt the song was a blatant ripoff of their father's hit, You've Got to Give It Up. This controversy got so heated that both parties went to court for a drawn-out legal battle over the validity of the claims that Pharrell and Thicke did, in fact, rip off the late Marvin Gaye. At first, Pharrell and Thicke claimed specifically that they were going for that Marvin Gaye, got to give it up kind of vibe, believe it or not. But only when they heard clamorings of unhappiness from the gay camp did they double back and say their song had no relation whatsoever to Marvin Gaye or the hit song. The trial was a circus. Robin Thicke claimed to be high on vodka and Vicodin during the recording sessions and should therefore be absolved of any wrongdoing. Meanwhile, Pharrell stated he only heard the similarity of the two songs after Blurred Lines was released. According to their spokesperson, quote, "While we respect the judicial process, we are extremely disappointed in the ruling made today, which sets a horrible precedent for music and creativity going forward. Blurred Lines was created from the heart and minds of Pharrell, Robin, and T.I., and not taken from anyone or anywhere else. We are reviewing the decision, considering our options, and you will hear more from us about this matter." End quote. The court ruled in favor of Marvin Gaye's estate, and his family walked away with $4 million. The jury felt that the infringement wasn't on purpose, but wasn't an innocent mistake either.
I can honestly see why this case went to court. This, to me, is not a cut and dry example of taking exact notes and copying a song, but more of lifting the essence in the groove of another song. This is about as close as you can get to ripping off a song without actually ripping off the song. They took the Marvin Gaye template and they technically made a different song, but I can totally see, again, why this went to court. And I am glad that I am not a judge or in any kind of jury, because I have no idea on this one.
Angel of the deep, one more shot. the similarity between the main riff in Korn's song Ball Tongue off their first album and the breakdown in Morbid Angel's Angel of Disease has been widely discussed and argued over on the internet since I can remember. Many Korn fans say, "There's no way they ripped off Morbid Angel." And Morbid Angel fans say, "Fuck Korn." It is suspicious, however, that Morbid Angel's album Covenant came out 1 year before Korn's debut album, and Korn was supposedly going to release a cover of a Morbid Angel song, God of Emptiness, off that same album that Angel of Disease was on. Also, Korn guitarist Brian Head Welsh and singer Jonathan Davis both admit they were high on meth when writing Ball Tongue. So we've established the guys in Korn were fans of Morbid Angel, especially the album Covenant. They were not opposed to officially covering a song off that album, and they were not in their right minds when writing Ball Tongue. I wasn't able to find any information from the Morbid Angel camp on whether any legal action was ever pursued, but I'm assuming either nothing happened or it was settled out of court.
So I definitely think that Korn probably took some influence and maybe even a guitar riff from Morbid Angel. It was their major label debut, and they probably felt very pressured to put out a solid product. And I think they were drawing a little too close from their inspirations at the time. But with all that being said, ever since their first album, I think it's safe to say that Korn definitely defined a sound that is totally unique to them. I don't think anyone will argue that whether you like or dislike the band Korn. The band helped ignite a whole genre of music with new rock, and there hasn't really been any lack of creative ideas since this one incident has happened with Korn.
If everybody had an ocean across the USA, then everybody'd be surfing.
They're really rocking in Boston and Pittsburgh, PA.
When the Beach Boys released their second album, Surfin' USA, in 1963, the main hit single off the album with the same name sounded awfully familiar to a Chuck Berry song called Sweet Little 16. Beach Boys' main songwriter Brian Wilson even admitted, quote, "I was going with a girl called Judy Bowles, and her brother Jimmy was a surfer. He knew all the surfing spots. I started humming the melody to Sweet Little 16, and I got fascinated with the fact of doing it, and I thought to myself, God, what about trying to put surf lyrics to Sweet Little 16's melody," end quote. Now that would all be well and good if Chuck Berry got credit for Surfin' USA, but with the first release of the album, Berry's name was nowhere to be found in the liner notes. Eventually, after pressure from Berry's label, the Beach Boys gave credit and publishing rights to Chuck Berry, and everyone was seemingly happy.
But with such a blatant ripoff, though, it's offensive that they even tried to initially play it off as if they didn't just take a song verbatim and just put new lyrics over the top as if, you know, oh, it's cool, you know, this totally isn't just completely stealing from somebody else. The Beach Boys, for how innovative they became later on in their career, sure did borrow a lot from their influences in their early years, almost to the point of thievery, but that's just my opinion. Well, that's all for now. I am most likely going to do a part two to this video because I have many more examples of bands ripping off other artists. Have you ever heard a song on the radio or on the internet that you just thought sounded like another song that you previously heard? If so, let me know in the comment section below, and maybe I'll add that to my part two video or add it to my part three video. Until next time, have a good rest of your night.